Good evening. Welcome to our regular council meeting on Monday, August 20th, 2012. Mr. Ray Goose, will you please call the roll?
Kaplan.
Here.
Dunbar.
Here.
Kelly.
Here.
Stein.
Here.
Stevens.
Present.
Wilcox.
Here.
It's all present, Your Honor.
Thank you. We move to the approval of the minutes of the regular council meeting held Monday, August 6th, 2012. Councilwoman Dunbar has told me about a few changes she'd like to be made, and that will be submitted to Judy Hayes to do take care of. Seeing that, are there any other changes or corrections? Seeing no other changes or corrections, I'll sign the minutes of the August 6th, 2012 council meeting. The ordinance resolutions passed at that meeting at the conclusion of this meeting. We now move to personal communication from our citizens. At this point in time, if you'd like to address council tonight, please raise your hand, be recognized, come to the podium, state your name and address and your business tonight with Council Fran.
My name is Fran Mensch. I live at 3060 Chelsea Drive.
Welcome, Fran.
Thank you. There's a proposal on the table for developing Meadowbrook and Lee that includes tax abatements and transfer of city-owned land for free or below market value to a private developer. The question is, should this land be developed? If this was private property being sold, it would be none of my business. But this is public land that citizens have already put $1 million into. This $1 million was a wise investment. It remediated the former sites of two gas stations. But we should not throw this investment away, or worse yet, transfer this resource to a private developer. There is no market demand to develop this land. In fact, doing so will hurt the economy currently in operation in this area. I did a walking inventory, which I sent to council members. I did a walking inventory of the Lee Road commercial area. I noted the vacant storefronts, the vacant commercial space, and apartments for rent along the way. The highlighted areas on these sheets indicate vacant retail areas and apartment buildings, with signs out front indicating that there are apartments for rent. As you can see, there are many highlighted areas. This inventory, you should note, did not include vacancies on any of the second floors. And in order to accurately measure the economic vitality of the area, you should really walk down the side streets. I looked down the side streets and I noted little or no economic spillover on any of these side streets other than Cedar. Additional statistics to consider are these from the Neo Can-Do Center at Case Western Reserve and from the U.S. Census. In the last 20 years, Cleveland Heights' population has declined by 8,000. During the same time, we have added 594 housing units. The housing vacancy rate almost tripled in those 20 years from 3.89% to 11.14%. But more relevant is that during the last 10 years, the vacancy rate of the city's housing units went from 4.06% to 11.14%. None of these numbers, none of these statistics, none of this data supports building more housing or commercial space. At the very least, this land that we own, the land that is being public, that is publicly held, should be sold at fair market value, not given or sold at a special price to a private developer. This transfer of public funds to a private entity is inappropriate in this situation. If money is the only factor that counts in a decision like this, then the most valuable land in the city is probably the land that Coventry Peace Park sits on. But no one would consider selling that in order to generate cash for the city coffers. People recognize its value to the community is far beyond the amount of money it would generate in taxes if it were developed. Building on the $1 million investment that we citizens have already made to the Meadowbrook Lee land, a committee of volunteers could work on a plan and find the funding necessary to turn Meadowbrook Lee into something unique and wonderful, the Lee Road version of the Coventry Peace Park.
Thank you, Fran. Anyone else like to address council tonight? Gentleman in the back, please.
Good evening. My name is Bob Myers. I live at 1945 Staunton Road in Cleveland Heights.
Welcome, Bob.
Thank you. My family has owned that house since 1956. I attended the Cleveland Heights, University Heights school system my whole life, as did my four sisters. I am here to talk against the proposed tax incentive for the Lee Meadowbrook apartment project. Basically, I've worked on 300 movies and TV shows, Pirates of the Caribbean, Jurassic Park 3, The Avengers, just to name a few. I've also worked on many projects as a producer throughout the country, which involve tax incentives. And in every case, the work that is promised gets done. All the money is spent, and accounting is done, and only then are the tax incentives received. And if the project does not meet all the requirements, you don't get any of the money. I don't see those taxpayer protections in this project or any of the early housing projects in Cleveland Heights, and that the land donations mentioned in the developers' economy benefit statements certainly caught my eye, as did the proposed $3 million tax abatement proposed. They say if you build it, they will come. And that's only true in the movie business. So, not for wishful thinking on civic projects. I hope the members of the council will reopen the search for the best way to develop this valuable land resource, because this proposal is full of holes. Thank you.
Thank you, Bob. Mr. Cantor.
Hi, I'm Gary Cantor. I live at 3624 Cummings Road.
Welcome, Gary.
Thank you. I'm going to detour from my prepared remarks briefly in order to disagree with Fran Mensch. Fran says that property has no value being developed. I don't know that I agree with her. I think it's a lovely lot at a great location. I'm not aware it has any impairments as a real estate investment. I think it's worth a lot. But there's no appraisal. There's no independent market appraisal. So how do I know if she's right that it's worthless, or that I'm right that it's worth a million or more? We don't know. Interestingly, there's a whole group of people here who went through a similar discussion about the Millikan School. And by golly, the minute those two appraisals were done and made public, there was a meeting of minds. From that moment on, it's been kumbaya. Because that's what thank you. Nothing like stacking the house. I would like to continue discussing the red warning flags I see everywhere I look regarding the proposed Meadowbrook Lee apartment building project. This is the Cleveland Heights City org chart off the website. I showed it once before. That's citizens up here at the top. Somewhere below the citizens is city council. And nowhere on here does it say developers. So when city council gets into a partnership with a developer, I don't know how to interpret this org chart anymore. And it's more than just a rhetorical question, because the last couple, 3 weeks, representative democracy has failed me. I've called almost every person sitting behind a name tag here. Many of you returned my calls and spent considerable time giving me thoughtful answers. and I thank each and every one of you that did so. Mr. Stein, I left some voicemails over a period of 3 weeks. Your voicemail says, I will try to call you back in 24 hours. Not a one. Vice Mayor Wilcox, you and I did a version of Abbott and Costello's Who's On First in our phone conversation. Very circular. And I spoke with the mayor, who felt I was against his proposal because it's bad. And I said, well, actually, my
correct conversation was, I said, I'm for the proposal, you're obviously against the proposal. And the bad was never mentioned in our four and a half minute conversation.
Against the proposal. Very good. And I said, well, I don't know that I'm against it because I can't find the data that you must have in order to draw a favorable conclusion about it. And the mayor said to me, well, who asked you to analyze anything? And I said, I'm a citizen, thank you, and I hung up. Now, is that how they're going to treat their partner? I don't know. This is from the partnership agreement. This is from the economic impact statement that the developer submitted on Wednesday or Thursday of last week. Quote, however, financing in the
Please address your comments to council, please.
Yeah, I apologize. However, financing in the current economy poses many challenges. This is why a partnership between the city and a developer will achieve mutually beneficial benefits. Well, whose needs does the city council prioritize? The citizens or their partners? I don't like that. Also from the economic impact statement is this. The city's investment could include subsidies, such as tax abatements, grants, and donated land. For these investments, the cities would receive numerous benefits, as will be illustrated herein. I've got the city's request for development proposal. I don't see anything about tax abatements, grants, or land donations. So maybe what you got is the best proposal from somebody who had an idea of land donations, grants, and tax abatements. But since that wasn't mentioned in the RFDP, maybe there's a lot of other good developers who didn't know about the availability of those things, and they didn't submit a proposal. But we're anxious to get a shovel in the ground in the fall. I believe that's a quote from the mayor.
Correct.
So we'll probably never find out if there's better developments out there, which is a pity. Thank you.
Thank you, Gary. Anyone else like to address council tonight? Anyone else want to address council tonight? Yes, sir, please.
My name is Akiva Feinstein. I live at 3731 Bendemeer.
Welcome tonight.
Thank you very much. So I came here really planning just to speak about Milliken and to offer some hope and some thanks to the people in front of me who worked really hard on making this thing work. And I realize it's not the end of the road. You know, a decision has to be made tonight. But as a community, we're very excited about the big steps that were taken. The people who thought very boldly, the people just didn't follow simple political affiliations or do what's best for them. People really acted beyond their normal roles. They looked at Cleveland Heights in general as what's good for the community, what's good for all the people, and they realized if you do things the old-fashioned way, they won't necessarily work. And these are quite obvious things I don't really have to rehash, but I feel like I should mention them because there's a lot of negativity in the room about this Lee Meadowbrook property. And I think that some of the concerns that people here came to speak about are perhaps opposed or pushed off by the way that the council dealt with the Milliken issue. They really were very open and very optimistic. They looked in different directions than they were necessary than other people were going, and they sought a different kind of solution. And I think that on behalf of the community that's behind the Milliken transaction, we thank the council, we thank the mayor, Jason Stein in particular, for their openness and for their trustworthiness in helping us to achieve, hopefully, the special milestone moment.
Anyone else want to address council tonight? Seeing no one else?
Oh, no, you got
I'm sorry. Please. I missed you.
Hebrew, I'm Chaim Yerachmiel. English, I'm Harvey Usant.
And your address?
My mom's address is 3818 Bainbridge Road. I'm at 3484 Berkeley.
Good to have you here tonight.
Thank you so much. I'm for the Millikan thing, but I just wanted to bring up something that I found bothersome for a number of years, and I was wondering if council can maybe help with it. It used to be when we could walk down the streets, and the sidewalks were completely clear. We had no problem. Over the past few years, they stopped trimming the trees, and it's very, very difficult to walk down the street many times without getting your hat or your head knocked off, especially if it rains or it snows. And I was wondering if maybe council could maybe find some way
to... Mr. Alex Mannarino is here. He heard you, and I would assume in the next few weeks he'll be more than happy to carry over his forestry staff, about seven or eight people, I believe, work in forestry, to take a look at your particular issues in the Taylor Road area. More than happy to address it anytime. But next time, call Jason. Just kidding. We'll take care of it. It won't be done in a day, but Alex will take care of it. For the record, that was easier than the Millikan deal. Anyone else want to talk with council? I know Mr. Rapport does, but we're going to save him for when the legislation comes up. But we're only going to let him have 5 minutes or less to speak. So we're going to move. We're going to move pretty quick. We are going to change the order of the committee reports around and move the Millikan issue to first, and then we'll take a short break. But I want to start with the report of our city manager, Susanna O'Neill.
Your Honor, I have two items this evening for council. One, I request permission to go out for bid on the Middlehurst Waterline Replacement Project, and that goes from Mayfield to Hampshire.
It's made a matter of record referred to the Municipal Service Committee of Council. Councilwoman Kaplan, please.
Thank you. I move that the city manager be given the authority to advertise for bids for the Middlehurst Road Waterline Replacement Project.
Is there a second?
Second.
Second by Councilwoman Dunbar. Any discussion? Mr. Ragus, will you please call the roll?
Dunbar?
Aye.
Kelly?
Aye.
Stein?
Aye.
Stevens?
Aye.
Wilcox?
Aye.
Kaplan?
Aye.
That's six ayes, Your Honor.
Authority to advertise for bids is granted.
Thank you. Secondly, is referring to the appointment of the new finance director. I'm pleased to announce that Tom Ragus has been selected to be the finance director for the City of Cleveland Heights. Mr. Ragus has been with the city since April 2011, when he was hired as the city's assistant finance director. When the former finance director left, Mr. Ragus was appointed the acting finance director in March 2012. Mr. Ragus is a graduate of Regis University in Denver with a Master's of Business Administration with a major in finance and accounting. Prior to coming to the city, he worked for the Auditor of the State of Ohio, first as an assistant auditor from 2005 to 2008 and promoted to an audit manager from 2008 to 2011. During the last few months, Mr. Ragus has proven himself to be conscientious, fiscally responsible, and very knowledgeable regarding finance and budgeting. The Cleveland Heights Charter, Article 5, Section 2, provides for the city manager to make the appointment of the finance director. However, it will only become effective with the approval of City Council. I request that City Council move to approve the appointment of Tom Ragus as the city's finance director.
Made a matter of record, refer to the Finance Committee of Council. Councilwoman Stevens, please.
Mr. Mayor and my colleagues, it is with great pleasure that I welcome and congratulate Mr. Ragus in his promotional opportunity and his, I'm assuming, acceptance of that promotional opportunity. To join, since I'm an alumni of directorship in this organization, welcome to the ranks. You will be tested. You will be asked a lot of questions. We hope you have patience with us and our clients, which are the citizens of Cleveland Heights. And thank you for accepting this promotion. I recommend approval to my colleagues, and I believe we have a voice vote that we take on
this. We have to get a second. Is there a second?
I second.
Second by Councilman Kaplan. Any discussion? Anyone want to comment? I briefly want to comment. I usually don't like state auditors, to be honest with you, from my 25 years in divorce court working on audits of all states and sizes. But, Tom, I got to give you credit. Tom Malone decided to retire in a short period of time, and you've really seized the opportunity to show your strengths with our city. You still have a little bit of growing to do, but we're looking forward to working with you. There's someone special here tonight I'd like you to introduce to everyone here.
My fiancée, Rebecca Newman.
Rebecca, stand up and be recognized. Oh, boy. So we're getting the whole team, right? This is the team approach?
What do you mean the team approach?
Isn't she a state auditor also?
Yes, she is a state auditor.
She has that account, yeah.
So we're going to get the team approach to our finance department. But Tom, I want to congratulate you. Looking forward to working with you. The hallmark of this city, the two hallmarks of this city are finances and safety. And now you are the director of finances, and you got to have to find us some more money.
I will do my best. It's hard with the budget.
Congratulations. We're looking forward to working with you. And
thank you.
So, Mr. Ragus, will you please call the vote to put you on officially by this city council?
Kelly?
Aye.
Stein?
Aye.
Stevens?
Aye.
Wilcox?
Aye.
Kaplan?
Aye.
Dunbar?
Aye.
That's six ayes, Your Honor, and thank you very much.
Mr. Ragus is effectively appointed the finance director. Let's give him a welcoming round of applause. Anything else, Susanna?
I just want to say on behalf of all the staff people here at City Hall, what an absolute pleasure it has been to work with Tom the last few months. He's very accessible. He knows what he's talking about. And he's very straightforward. And it will be a wonderful thing for the city to have Tom Ragus as its finance director.
Thank you, Susanna.
Thanks, Susanna.
We move to the report of the Director of Finance, Clerk of Council, Mr. Ragus.
I need to notify Council that one resolution of the Board of Zoning Appeals has been received pertaining to a variance in the zoning code and is requested by the following. BZA calendar number 3289, Melody Walkie, 840 Keystone Drive, 4-foot tall fence in the corner side yard. Your Honor, I need to make this a matter of record.
It's made a matter of record. Refer to the Planning and Development Committee of Council for disposition later during the committee report.
I have nothing else to report, Your Honor.
It is time for committee reports. We're going to jump to Committee Report F, which is our Planning and Development Committee, with Resolution 127-2012, which I think interests almost everybody in the room tonight. Vice Mayor Wilcox, please.
Okay, thank you. I'm going to take this out of order. I hope nobody objects. Resolution 127-2012 is a resolution authorizing the city manager to execute a non-binding proposal for the lease of the Severance Millikan School from the Cleveland Heights University Heights School District and sublease the property to Mostos Ora Tora and declaring an emergency. The school district owns certain real property, which is known as the Severance Millikan School. Mostos has expressed an interest in either purchasing or leasing a portion of that building for a nonprofit, non-public school chartered by the state of Ohio. And the school district has proposed and the city has expressed a willingness in principle to enter into a cooperative agreement as provided in Ohio Revised Code Section 75516, pursuant to which the city would lease a portion of that property from the school district and then sublease the property to Mostos. This non-binding proposal, which outlines the proposed lease transaction, has been prepared by legal counsel for the school district and is attached to this resolution. The district, the city, and Mostos are each being asked to approve the non-binding lease proposal. This resolution then authorizes the city manager to execute a non-binding lease proposal substantially in the form that's attached. And just briefly, the lease proposal provides as follows. And I'm just going to hit some of the high points here. The existing school building and certain of the adjacent land would be leased, but not the stables and some of the adjacent land. Mostos will use the property primarily as a nonprofit, nonpublic school chartered by the state pursuant to Ohio Revised Code 330116. Mostos may also use this property for adult education programs, outdoor recreational facilities, to the extent these uses are permitted by the city. The term of this lease would be 30 years, with two consecutive options for renewal of 10 years each. The rent is $1 per year, but the required improvements are $1.5 million into the school, which would be put in six-month increments, essentially, $500,000 after 6 months, $1 million after a year, and then 18 months would be the following improvements. Additional improvements can be made subject to approval of the city, and there are certain contingencies in here, including obtaining a conditional use permit from the city. So Resolution 127-2012 sets forth the first step, but a very important first step in getting this transaction done. I know everybody's worked very hard on this, and I want to thank Mostos, the Board of Education, for working together to find common ground. This is certainly a win-win for everybody involved, and I think more importantly, it's a win for the entire community. And I'm very pleased to be able to offer this legislation tonight. So I offer Resolution 127-2012 for passage tonight.
Resolution 127-2012 has been offered. Before we get to council comments, if there are any, I'm going to ask Mr. Rappaport if you want to spend a couple minutes and update us. Do you feel the need? Name and address for the record, please.
Thank you, Your Honor. Alan Rappaport, 1567 Compton Road.
Welcome, Alan.
Thank you. I'm here tonight representing Mostos. I'll keep my remarks brief. I think you're all fairly familiar with the history of this. The silence that has been going on for several months doesn't mean that there hasn't been a lot of active discussion. The negotiation was very professional, and we tried to be very thorough in the process of that. We've put together something which is fairly creative. I think you're all aware that Mostos, at the very beginning, preferred to purchase the property. The school board made it very clear from the outset that they were more interested in leasing. We promised to keep an open mind on the subject. And we believe that the agreement that is in front of you right now, which is, of course, preliminary, does adjust the basic objectives of both parties. I would point out that being a long-term agreement, it might be mutually modified someday in the future. Personally, I expect discussions of that course to happen. But 30 years from now, if I'm still around, I'll be 93 years old. And I'm not sure I'll be actively participating at that time. Other people will have to decide based upon the conditions as they change. But what we've done right now is we've tried to come up with the best overall understanding of how to make this project happen. You heard the term chartered, by the way, in the resolution that was read. Mostos does have a charter. There's a distinction in state law between a charter school and a school that has a charter. A school that has a charter is a school that meets certain state requirements as far as the quality of educational programming. And Mostos does have a charter. So we're not talking about putting some kind of fly-by-night operation into a building and giving the keys to an organization that doesn't have a track record. This organization has been around for, I believe, 28 years, and 34 years, sorry. And much to my surprise, they've managed to do this without any funding from the Federation, from the Jewish Community Federation. They've been able to be self-supporting during that period of time, and they have two facilities in our community right now. So this is a mark of progress for that institution. It's also a mark of progress for our community to be able to take a property that you all know is in very bad condition, is a nuisance, probably could be knocked down by the city under the circumstances, and instead have substantial private investment in that property and turn it to productive use. I want to mention that this proposal envisions a partnership between three bodies, the school board, Mostos, and the city of Cleveland Heights. And to a very large extent, that has already occurred. I can tell you that this proposal would not be in front of you were it not for some substantial assistance and help that we got from Richard Wong, your director of planning, from John Gibbon, your director of law, and from Mayor Kelly, who at a very early point has been very supportive and very helpful in this entire process. It involved a lot of diplomacy, pinch of politics, and some good analysis of law. And we're not out of the woods yet. I would not call this to paraphrase Winston Churchill, the beginning of the end. I would call this the end of the beginning. We will proceed from here to see if we can, in fact, negotiate a lease agreement that fleshes out the terms that you have in front of you. There is ample opportunity for any of the three parties to state that they do not want to sign a lease in the end. The devil is always in the details, as the cliche goes. And I fully expect that in doing this, we're not only going to have the participation of lawyers representing the school board and MOSDOS, but we're going to have an added talent to the pool. We're going to have Mr. Gibbon, your law director, who I assure you will be looking out for the city's interest in particular. We do believe that if we get the green light from you tonight, that we will be able to proceed to a win-win-win solution on this, and that we can, in fact, put together a proposal that will be smiled upon 30 years from now. And in the interim period, we'll do something significant, not just to cement a relationship within Cleveland Heights and to improve a community. And I'm not just talking about the Orthodox Jewish community, but the entire geographic area in which those people are located. But maybe even more importantly than that, we're going to help educate children. I can't think of a much more noble task to be undertaking. Thank you.
Thank you.
Do you need a second to begin discussion?
No, we're ready to go. You said your comments, Dennis, or you have something else?
No, I just wanted to point out that this resolution, as was pointed out by council, is subject to a final lease that will be brought back before this city council and would be contingent upon a legal opinion from council satisfactory to our director of law. So we do have some due diligence to do and some more work, but again, this is a very important first step, and I think we can all congratulate ourselves for getting to this point. So I offer... Again, I offer Resolution 127-2012 for passage.
Councilwoman Kaplan, please.
Thank you. I feel like it's been years to get even to this point, and certainly it's not a done deal. And it's not how I personally would have preferred it. I would have preferred a sale. But if this is the best we could do, it seems pretty good to me, especially if there's such a long-term lease. What is it, 30 years with additional 2 10-year options? So that seems pretty good. And I'm really happy that we were all finally able to be creative and flexible. That was really the bottom line, is flexibility in trying to find a solution that would really work for everyone. We want the MOSDOS to stay in the community. We want you to stay in the community. And you're an important part of our community. So we've been, I know I've been pretty vocal. I feel like it's been almost a year ago that I started getting emails and started encouraging everybody make a lot of noise. And he sure did make a lot of noise. It worked out. And flexibility in all for everybody has really worked out. It's been a good lesson for everyone, I think, in how to make things come together. So it's a great way to look at the beginning of a school year that hopefully for the next school year, the students will be in a new place, and I think it's really pretty terrific. So congratulations to all involved.
Councilwoman Stevens, please.
Actually, I think this was a great lesson in civics for a lot of us. The first approach didn't quite work, but you understood how government worked, and you made it work for you. And so that is a lesson learned by adults and taught in such a way that the children in front of us learn it for the future. It is important to stay involved in government. It is important for you to talk to us so that we understand what you want and so that we know what is our responsibility to help deliver to you. And so while we couldn't do it by ourselves, we are in partnership. And often Jason and I talk about the partnerships that we have to have between our various communities and constituencies. It is so important for us to approach one another, tell each other what we want, want. And then sometimes it's not quite the way we envisioned it, because as Bonnie said, we had originally hoped that this would be a straight sale to you. But this works. It works to benefit all three of the parties that were at the table. And so what I ask you to do today and in the future is to continue to have faith in us. And in when we don't know exactly what you want, please don't hesitate to tell us. Thank you.
Councilman Stein, I think you may want to say something.
Well, first I want to clarify some misinformation that has been thrown out into the public realm on Patch and other websites, most recently from a man that spoke earlier, Gary Cantor. I do not have any conflict of interest that would preclude me from voting on the school board most dose resolution tonight. No conflict. These false accusations against me are just that, false and unfounded. I'm a proud parent of most dose children. I'm a proud resident of the Millikan District. And I am an elected official of the greatest city in the nation. My voting on issues of importance to the citizens of Cleveland Heights is what I have been elected to do. If elected officials had to recuse themselves from voting on issues of importance to the city they represent just because they have children in a school or they have publicly supported a nonprofit, there would be few votes that elected officials would be able to vote on. I will participate and vote tonight. With that item now clear, I want to welcome each of you back to Cleveland Heights City Council chambers. Hundreds of Millikan neighbors and other concerned Cleveland Heights residents filled the same room at our February 21st meeting earlier this year to ask for Council's help to reestablish the former Millikan as a community asset. Much history has brought us to this point in time. However, tonight is not about the previous many years of hard work and persistence in the effort to rejuvenate the former Millikan school. Tonight is about our future. For the last 7 years, the Millikan neighbors have been patiently, but with great worry, waiting for the school board to make a decision about Millikan. Well, the decision to lease the Millikan school to Mostos or Hatora has been made. The neighbors now await the revitalization of the school and the reestablishment of the Millikan playground. I want to thank Mayor Ed Kelly for his leadership in making this happen. As well, I want to thank Vice Mayor Dennis Wilcox, Councilperson Cheryl Stevens, and Bonnie Kaplan for supporting the Millikan neighbors both publicly and behind the scenes. I thank the Cleveland Heights University Heights School Board members for unanimously approving this lease proposal. I thank Mostos Orat Torah's Shmuel Hoffman and Rabbi Morgenstern for having the vision and determination to persevere the last 7 years. There were many times that it did not look like Millikan would be repurposed. At times, it appeared that there was no hope to ever have Millikan used as a school again. Yet, Mostos did not abandon Cleveland Heights by relocating the school elsewhere. Mostos Orat Torah has made a huge commitment to Cleveland Heights, and this council recognizes that commitment and thanks you. Finally, I want to thank each of you that have taken the time to be active, taking part in the democratic process, and through your efforts, changing the course of events. Whether it was showing up at public meetings, speaking on behalf of Millikan neighbors, writing a letter to the editor, or contacting an official, each of you made a difference. Specifically, I want to thank a few Cleveland Heights residents that took a leadership role and gave countless hours of their time, energy, and talents. I thank Akiva Feinstein, Susan Afiamson, Rabbi Manny's, Jessica Cohen, Jennifer Cranus, Ben Hohen, and Rabbi Wolf. Now it is time for the next step. Over the coming months, there will be much work to do to prepare Millikan and its playground for use. Please keep working. As Alan said earlier, tonight is not the end. It is only the end of the beginning. Congratulations.
I just want to briefly, 6 months ago, we sat in this room Maybe a few more people came to visit us, or maybe about the same. But this is certainly is the right thing to do. Like so many things we've done in the city, our community center, this project makes me feel good, gives me goosebumps. It's something I look forward to. As I said in the media, I can't wait for the ribbon cutting, the first day of school. I'll have butterflies in my stomach. Hopefully you'll invite us to come. I'd love to be part of that special day, because it sets the table for the community for many, many years. It's not about the grown-ups, it's about the children. To give them the best educational environment possible. And what, go ahead. And I say, why not in Cleveland Heights? It's very simple. We wanted you here. Ari Jaffe, who was the attorney a long time ago, about 5, 6 years, I've been working with him for 5 or 6 years. I do want to compliment our school board. You know, they're in a tough position, but they came through when it counted, and we need them to do more things together like this. This, we all win. This is a great time. I will look back when I finish my career here, this, or the community center, some of the things we do, is some of the special things we made, but it shapes the community, as Alan said, for 50 years. And I hope soon, sooner than later, let's get the lease done, that you own the property. Because that's what I feel in my heart. And as far as this city council, we're only a phone call away, whether it's a tree, whether a pothole needs to be filled, whether we need to get you another school building, just call us and let us know. You know, we're here for you. You've always been here for us. This is a great opportunity. There are no downsides in this project. Just as in the next piece of legislation, when you all leave, we're working on Meadowbrook and Lee. That also warms me to think we're doing an $11 million project in the heart of Cedar and Lee with fantastic developers, with one of the best architects in the area, not just in the Cleveland area, around Paul Volpe, who's here. Let's recognize Paul in the back there. And the developer is here, David Orleans and Kenny Laurie. Why don't you stand up and be recognized, guys? So this is just part of the rebirth and revitalization of Cleveland Heights. Again, we're just a phone call away, but we will do our darndest to make sure this lease agreement is executed to everyone's satisfaction so we can move on and move forward and have that first day of school for everybody in the community. And again, we're just a phone call away when you need us. Tom, please call the roll.
Stein.
Aye.
Stevens.
Aye.
Wilcox.
Aye.
Kaplan.
Aye.
Dunbar.
Aye.
Kelly.
Aye.
That's 6 ayes, Your Honor.
Thank you. And before I let you go, I just want to say thanks to a very special person, Alan Rappaport. Who had a lot of starts and stops. A lot of frustrations. We talked on the phone. We did a lot of stuff together. But you know what? He's a damn good guy, and he has your interest at heart, and he really made this happen. And I think we deserve to give him a standing ovation for what he did. All right, if you want to leave, we're not going to be offended. We'll adjourn for a couple minutes.
Same thing.
continue forward or come back?
It's up to you. You want me?
The camera's supposed to be at Dennis.
We're going back to him.
You want to make sure.
Oh, okay.
You ready to start ready. Back up?
Yep.
You ready to go?
Yep.
All right, we're going to restart. We're back in Planning and Development Committee of Council. We have another piece of legislation and a Board of Zoning Appeals matter that Vice Mayor Wilcox will take up.
Okay. Next, I have find the Resolution 128-2012. This is a resolution certifying a proposed agreement between the city and the Orlean Company or related entity to grant tax abatement for development of the property currently owned by the city known as 2223 Lee Road and declaring an emergency. The city owns property as described. It's 1+ acres at 2223 Lee Road, and the city acquired the property and assisted with economic or environmental remediation for the purpose of economic development. And this has taken quite a few years, basically almost 10 years. In November of 2011, the city issued a request for development proposal for development of the property and received proposals from several interested development companies. Council then, after reviewing these proposals and interviewing various developers, determined that the proposal submitted by the Orlean Company for mixed-use development of the site, which includes a commercial component as well as residential apartments, best meets the needs of the city and the Cedar Lea commercial area. The city is proposing, in the process of negotiating a development agreement with the Orlean Company, which may include the granting of 80% tax abatement for a period of 11 years for both the commercial and the residential components of the development. And Ohio law requires that if this tax abatement exceeds 50%, the school board needs to approve the same. So the resolution 128-2012 provides as follows. Pursuant to section 3735.671 of the revised code of Ohio, council certifies to the Cleveland Heights University School Board the proposed agreement for tax abatement on the commercial portion of the proposed development at 2223 Lee Road within the city of Cleveland Heights as more fully described and identified in the attached exhibit. And then pursuant to that section of the code, requests the school board to take action on this approval, on this proposal within 45 days of the effective date of this resolution, which excludes Saturdays, Sundays, and legal holidays. And then further provides that council notifies the school board and stipulates that the date upon which approval of the tax abatement agreement with the Orlean Company will be formally considered by the city of Cleveland Heights is December 3rd, 2012 or earlier, if permitted by law. So this resolution is really a technical and important technical first step in the tax abatement process for this development. And you've heard different comments about this development tonight, but I would like to first say that City Council reviewed a number of development proposals, and again, we felt this was the best development proposal. It's a combination of residential and commercial on Lee Road and an important part of our city and our commercial district at Cedar and Lee. Again, tax abatement is the first, this is the first step in the process and includes further review by both the Board of Education and the City of Cleveland Heights. And this project will also be reviewed by our boards and commissions as any large development project will be. This development, moreover, is consistent with the city's strategic development plan, which was approved by City Council in the last year, and will be a substantial benefit to the Cedar Lea area. Some will be against any kind of tax abatement or public subsidy for projects, but in today's world, such subsidies and tax abatements are sometimes necessary. Some people will also oppose any kind of development at all. But in representing all the citizens of Cleveland Heights, I must consider the benefits of new housing and businesses on Lee Road and the substantial benefits and revenues it will generate for the city as a result. Keeping the property vacant won't fill up other vacancies, residential or commercial, which may exist in our city. Rather, this development may spur other development and other filling up of vacancies in the area, and it will be a benefit to the entire Cedar Lea area. So I offer Resolution 128-2012 for passage tonight.
Resolution number 128-2012 has been offered. Any comments or questions? Councilman Kaplan, please.
Yes, I need to abstain from voting on this. In the beginning of the process, when there was a request for a proposal, my son-in-law was one of the one of the developers who put in a proposal. So I have not been privy to any of the information about this project. So therefore, I need to abstain from voting on this.
We need a motion from council, from the remaining five members of council.
I would move to permit Councilwoman Kaplan to abstain as noted.
Is there a second?
Second.
Any discussion? Mr. Ragus, if you call the roll, this is to allow Councilwoman Kaplan to abstain when the final vote is called on this issue, okay. This resolution.
Stevens?
Aye.
Wilcox?
Aye.
Dunbar?
Aye.
Kelly?
Aye.
Stein?
Aye.
That's five ayes, Your Honor.
Okay. Councilwoman Kaplan will be abstaining when the vote comes around. Any comments? Councilwoman Stevens, please.
One of the things that I take into consideration when looking at a project like this, because of my years of experience in real estate, tax and appraisal valuations, is to see whether there will be any additional economic impact from the project. With approximately 100 to 125 people as potential residential tenants in the residential units and approximately 14,000 square feet in commercial space, it would be easy to say that there'd be $100,000 spent somewhere in this marketplace. If the discretionary income of each of the residential tenants was only $10,000 that they spent in this marketplace. Recent studies by Case, Cleveland State University, and University of Akron say that the economic impact in areas like this ranges from 1.4 to 1.6. So easily on $100,000, there's $140,000 to $160,000 spent. We don't know what the real numbers are yet, but we would be able to, as we get closer to a final development of the proposal, which we will continue to negotiate with them until the school board is ready to accept an application, we'll see that there is income that will more than make up for any cash flow losses from tax abatement, from the actual impact of cash that flows into the businesses on the street, as well as our ability to tax the income of the residents or the folks who are employed in the commercial space. So I support this project and believe that it will benefit us in ways we had not expected it to in the future. So I have nothing but support for our continued negotiations with the team that the Meadowbrook Loop proposal represents.
Thank you. Councilman Stein?
Yeah, this development is exciting, and I'm excited to support the plan. It will bring significant tax dollars to the schools and property tax, to the city and income tax. It's going to create new jobs, and it's going to benefit the Lee Road Commercial District. It's a great deal all around for our citizens.
Thank you. Anyone else? You know, I just briefly want to say that, to have an opportunity like this in the heart of Cedar and Lea lets people know, not just here in Cleveland Heights, but in the whole region, that Cleveland Heights is alive and well, ready to develop, ready to move forward. This is an exciting project with people we have a track record of doing business with, both the developers and the architect. Their work is all over Cleveland Heights. They've done fine work from single-family houses to bluestone across the street. We are so looking forward to making this happen. This is the missing tooth on Lee Road, or missing teeth, so to speak. We got involved, 8-10 years ago, trying to clean it up, make something happen. Cedar and Lea is alive and well, and when we get done with this project, it'll be better, stronger, continue to be a destination place. We're going to bring new residents, new energy. We're going to clear up a hole, so to speak. And if we sat back and did nothing, we'd have an empty gas station there and a bank building that's moved down the street and some grass and a couple picnic tables. And what would that mean to us in Cleveland Heights? Absolutely nothing. And if we really wanted to, we could put another gas station there. I'm sure Get Go or Quick Pick or one of somebody's gas stations would come here in a minute. But that's not what we do here in Cleveland Heights. We are moving towards the future. This project, and I'm talking to Mr. Orleans and Mr. Kenny Ori now, sets the table for the next 3 to 5 to 10 years in Cleveland Heights. And I want to mention the word in that table, top of the hill, could possibly be right around the corner. So go forth. Let's get this development agreement done. Let's work with our school board. Let's make it happen. And let's make this the best project that you, that the three of you have ever done. Because it'll be a project that we're going to be showing around for years to come, and it'll, we'll model stuff after it in the future. This is special, guys. You know it. Paul, when you were at the school board, you just blew us away, and it was a great presentation. You all did a nice job. But the financial stuff, that's great, and that'll help the city, certainly. But it'll continue the energy and viability of Lee Road. It'll help the theater. It'll help the restaurants. It'll help the apartments. It'll even help Subway on the corner of Meadowbrook and Lee. So, you know, good things are happening, and I'm proud to be working with you guys. Let's move it forward. Kenny, no calls for about a week, though, please. No calls. All right. Mr. Ragus, will you please call the roll?
Wilcox.
Aye.
Dunbar.
Aye.
Kelly.
Aye.
Stein.
Aye.
Stevens.
Aye.
That's 5 ayes, Your Honor.
Resolution number, wait a minute. You got to, Bonnie has to absolutely abstain on the record.
Kaplan.
Abstain.
Sorry
we
about
have
that.
We have 5 ayes and
5
one
ayes and 1 abstain.
Okay. Thank you. You guys are more than welcome to stay, but you're not going to hurt our feelings if you want to get up and quickly go out the door, catch Mr. Rappaport in the atrium. Thank you.
Then come back to that one.
Yeah. Yeah, you might do it. All right. Then we'll just start at the top with Jason.
Good to see everybody. Good evening.
Thank you.
Thank you. Jason, he's going to do the BZA, then we'll start with you.
Okay.
All right. Continuing to take things out of order, planning and development. I have a Board of Zoning Appeals resolution, calendar 3289. Melody Walkie at 840 Keystone Drive in an A single family district made an application for a variance from the accessory structure and fence height regulations of the zoning code to permit a 4 foot tall fence in the corner side yard with 4 inch wide pickets and 1 inch spacing set back 3 feet from the sidewalk. The required maximum height is 3 feet. It was a public hearing on August 15th at 7 p.m. at Council Chambers, and in the opinion of the Board of Zoning Appeals, the applicant will suffer practical difficulty if the variance is not granted because the 4 foot tall fence located in a code conforming location significantly reduces the total usable fenced area. Similar corner side yards, fences greater than 3 feet exist in this neighborhood, and corner properties lack privacy expected in non-corner properties. The site is also located in a high traffic area, and the fence will afford privacy and containment for present and future owners. Issuance of a special permit is authorized to permit a 4 foot tall fence in the corner side yard, as noted. And construction to begin within 18 months. And I should note that this fence design had already been approved by the Architectural Board of Review. So I move for approval of calendar 3289.
PZA calendar number 3289 has been offered. Is there a second?
Second.
Second by Councilman Stevens. Any discussion? Greg, will you please call the roll?
Kaplan.
Aye.
Dunbar.
Aye.
Kelly.
Aye.
Stein.
Aye.
Stevens.
Aye.
Wilcox.
Aye.
That's 6 ayes, Your Honor.
PZA calendar number 3289 is granted.
Want me to go ahead and make my comments now?
Please okay. Do. Finish your report.
I just had one comment to make, and that is, it's hard to believe, but summer is almost over because the last free parking weekend in Cleveland Heights is coming up this weekend, Friday, August 24th, Saturday, August 25th, Sunday, August 26th. So anywhere you see a meter in Cleveland Heights, it is free. Don't put money in it, and enjoy the free parking weekend. And that concludes my report.
Thank you, Vice Mayor. We'll go back in order. Public Safety and Health Committee. Councilman Stein, you got a little work ahead of you tonight here.
Thank you, Your Honor. I have resolution number 122, 2012, a resolution declaring the property at 889 Helmsdale Road to be a nuisance, authorizing abatement of the nuisance, and declaring an emergency. This is the Helmsdale property. Whereas the city manager and the certified building official have reported to this council that the residential property known as 889 Helmsdale Road owned by Deborah Jackson and Carl Harris Sr., has not been maintained for a number of years and is in a state of severe disrepair. It is hereby found and determined by this council, pursuant to Chapter 553 of the codified ordinances of the City of Cleveland Heights, that the premises known as 889 Helmsdale Road, owned by Deborah Jackson and Carl Harris Sr., is in a state of disrepair to the extent that it constitutes a health and safety hazard and a blighting influence, and is hereby declared to be a public nuisance. I offer Resolution 122-2012 for passage tonight.
Resolution number 122-2012 has been offered. Any comments or questions? Mr. Ragusa, will you please call the roll?
Dunbar?
Aye.
Kelly?
Aye.
Stein?
Aye.
Stevens?
Aye.
Wilcox?
Aye.
Kaplan?
Aye.
That's six ayes, Your Honor.
Resolution number 122-2012 passes.
I have a resolution number 123-2012, a resolution declaring the property at 3064 Meadowbrook Boulevard to be a nuisance, authorizing abatement of the nuisance and declaring an emergency. This Meadowbrook property is actually at the corner of Cottage Grove and Meadowbrook. I've seen it. City manager and the certified building official have reported to this council that the residential property known as 3064 Meadowbrook Boulevard, owned by the estate of Olive June Black, has not been maintained for a number of years and is in a state of severe disrepair. It is hereby found and determined by this council, pursuant to Chapter 553 of the Codified Ordinances of the City of Cleveland Heights, that the premises known as 3064 Meadowbrook Boulevard, owned by the estate of Olive June Black, in a state of disrepair to the extent that it constitutes a health and safety hazard and a blighting influence, and is hereby declared to be a public nuisance. I offer resolution number 123-2012 for passage tonight.
Resolution number 123-2012 has been offered. Any comments or questions? Mr. Ragusa, will you please call the roll?
Kelly?
Aye.
Stein?
Aye.
Stevens?
Aye.
Wilcox?
Aye.
Kaplan?
Aye.
Dunbar?
Aye.
That's six ayes, Your Honor.
Resolution number 123-2012 passes.
All right, and one more resolution, number 124-2012. Resolution declaring the property at 3145 Meadowbrook Boulevard to be a nuisance, authorizing abatement of the nuisance and declaring an emergency. 3145 Meadowbrook. Whereas the city manager and the certified building official have reported to this council that the residential property known as 3145 Meadowbrook Boulevard, owned by Rafiq Ilyas Watson, aka Rafiq Watson, has not been maintained for a number of years and is in a state of severe disrepair. It is hereby found and determined by this council, pursuant to Chapter 553 of the Codified Ordinances of the City of Cleveland Heights, that the premises known as 3145 Meadowbrook Boulevard, owned by Rafiq Watson, in a state of disrepair to the extent that it constitutes a health and safety hazard and a blighting influence, and is hereby declared to be a public nuisance. I offer resolution number 124-2012 for passage tonight.
Resolution number 124-2012 has been offered. Any comments or questions? Mr. Ragusa, will you please call the roll?
Stein?
Aye.
Stevens?
Aye.
Wilcox?
Aye.
Kaplan?
Aye.
Dunbar?
Aye.
Kelly?
Aye.
That's six ayes, Your Honor.
Resolution number 124-2012 passes.
Fast and furious tonight. All done.
Thank you. Administrative Service Committee is up next. Councilwoman Dunbar, please.
Yes, just two items. Council will be interviewing three executive search firms before the end of this month to choose one to assist us in the search for a city manager. We are looking at firms that specialize in such searches. The second item is I wanted to reiterate that the deadline for applications to fill the seat on City Council vacated by the resignation of Phyllis Evans has been extended to 5 p.m. September 10th. I invite everyone who would like to serve on City Council and feels they have the skill set to contribute effectively to submit their application. That's it.
Thank you, Councilwoman. We move to the Community Relations and Recreation Committee of Council. Vice Chair, Councilwoman Kaplan, please.
Thank you. There is no legislation this evening. I did want to say a big thank you to all the staff of the pool, of our recreational facilities, and of Kane Park. It has been a phenomenal season. The pool has been jumping, literally. The weather was had very hot days, and so I think we doubled the number of people who were in the pool over last year. So the pool was always very busy. We had a wonderfully successful year. The water was always fantastic, I know, because I go virtually every day. It really was wonderfully organized, in control, and everybody had a great time. And going to that pool is an experience to see what Cleveland Heights is all about. It's really fantastic, and everybody involved did a great job. And then, of course, Kane Park. Kane Park had the most exciting season we've had literally in years. It was phenomenal. And this past week was Jackson Brown, sold out the whole place. 2,400 people were there. It closed up this weekend with the doo-wops and two performances by Groundworks. It was fantastic. Everybody has a good time. It made me so proud to be there. And so if you didn't go, you missed something great, and write down on your calendars to remember to go next year. But it took a lot of staff time, from Public Works to all the people who have something to do with the theater. What a great job. And don't forget that we had that great art festival. It has just been a wonderful summer. So thank you to every single person involved. It was great.
Thank you, Councilwoman. We move to the Finance Committee of Council. Councilwoman Stevens, please.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor. The first piece of legislation up from the Finance Committee is Ordinance Number 125-2012. This is an ordinance amending certain subparagraphs of Ordinance 154-2011 relating to appropriations and other expenditures of the City of Cleveland Heights for the fiscal year ending December 31st, 2012. Certain paragraphs of Ordinance Number 54 are related to the appropriations and expenditures of the city. And so in Fund 101, which is a general fund, we see that the amount of our annual budget is $40,582,285. We need to increase that amount by $1,150,000 so that our total amount of potential revenue for 2012 is amended to be $41,732,285. We have received an increase in our revenues from unprojected and welcome, because everything costs more than you ever thought it would. Increase in the real estate tax is projected and the income tax is projected. We try to conservatively do our projections, and so when it is time to begin the collections, we were pleasantly surprised to find out that our transfer of collections to RITA has exceeded our projections, as well as real estate taxes came in a little bit higher. So those were welcome increases in revenues. In addition, we received from Zagaras the final payment for the tax increment financing deal that was structured for the land underneath their building, and that was a payment of $1,150,000. That needs to be placed in our Economic Development Fund, which is Fund 411, and therefore that is a transfer. So we are amending our budget and making a transfer from one account into another account, and these things all need to be recognized by legislation. So this ordinance, I submit this ordinance to the balance of my colleagues for approval, Mr. Mayor.
Ordinance number 125-2012 has been offered. Any comments or questions? Mr. Ragusa, will you please call the roll?
Stevens.
Aye.
Wilcox.
Aye.
Kaplan.
Aye.
Dunbar.
Aye.
Kelly.
Aye.
Stein.
Aye.
That's six ayes.
Ordinance number 125-2012 passes.
The second ordinance this evening for the Finance Committee is Ordinance Number 126-2012. It's an ordinance very similar to the one we just passed. An ordinance amending certain subparagraphs of Ordinance Number 154 relating to the appropriations and expenditures of the City of Cleveland Heights. In this case, we're amending the Fund 854, which is a miscellaneous fund, and there is a $625,000 $652,000, I transpose that, $797. This amount is to be moved from the Miscellaneous Agency Fund to Fund 411, which is the Economic Development Fund. This is a receipt of funds from the restructuring of a financial instrument that allowed the Kensington Apartment Building to be built approximately 20 years ago here on the Ring Road at Severance Circle. These funds will now be placed in the Economic Development Fund to be restructured into loans for attracting businesses or redevelopment opportunities into the City of Cleveland Heights. Mr. Mayor, I submit this to you and my colleagues for approval this evening.
Ordinance 126-2012 has been offered. Any comments or questions? Mr. Ragus, will you please call the roll?
Wilcox.
Aye.
Kaplan.
Aye.
Dunbar.
Aye.
Kelly.
Aye.
Stein.
Aye.
Stevens.
Aye.
That's six ayes, Your Honor.
Order number 126, 2012 passes.
That is it for the Finance Committee for this evening. Thank you.
Just moving money around to economic development purposes.
You know, I'm completely biased about that economic development money.
I would think so. The Municipal Service Committee of Council, Councilwoman Kaplan, doing double duty tonight.
Thank you. I have no legislation for municipal services, but I do want to read you something. I talk about recycling and why it's important, and I want you to hear another viewpoint about why your recycling really matters. I assume that some of you have paid attention to the London Olympics that were just over last week. And the London Olympics 2012 showcased a futuristic, stylish, and recyclable basketball stadium. Who knew? It is the first ever recyclable, non-permanent structure built for the Olympics. It also uses less than half the amount of steel compared to equal-sized stadiums, making it the lightest Olympic stadium to date. The structure is designed capable of being deconstructed and shipped elsewhere for use, probably for the next Olympic Games. The privilege of hosting the Olympics has always been awarded to countries who can accommodate outrageously expensive building projects. And the London Olympics was certainly not an exception to that. However, they made a bold move that may change the Olympic hosting forever. With the design of a recyclable stadium in the London Olympics, the same structure can be deconstructed and shipped to the new host country every 4 years. So I encourage you to think about what can recycling do, and wasn't that amazing, and it was a gorgeous structure besides. So we'll be interested to see what Rio is going to do, and they are now thinking about 9 permanent sites and 6 temporary venues, and one hopes that they also will do recyclable materials. That's all I have. Thank you.
Thank you. We'll move to the mayor's report. Just to piggyback on what Council Kaplan said, I want to thank Larry Shaw and Mike DeCenzo and the municipal service staff for keeping our fields in such excellent shape. You know, Larry does it year in and year out, every game, every inning. He's there, and Mike's a youth sports coordinator, and he'll be busy very soon with the start of soccer and flag football. So we are continuing to do things, and I just want to remind everyone, as I do this time of year, school's about ready to start. Be smart, drive slow, be safe, don't rush. You'll get there if you're a minute or two late. That's okay, your boss will be all right, but let's not compromise the safety of our kids by speeding up neighborhoods to get your kid or get in the front of the line or to cut somebody off. Let's be nice and nice and safety driven as we start school, and wishing our sports teams, our Heights sports teams, including Beaumont and Luther and East and St. Anne's, another great season like they had last year. We'll be busy having award ceremonies and going to games at all hours of the day and night and using our soccer fields. I'm looking for good things from our kids. That concludes the mayor's report at 8:58 and a half. Our next meeting will be Tuesday, September 4th, 2012. I want to thank you all for coming tonight.